Hello, welcome to this training. My name is Emmanuel Ogabidu. I'm an LEA specialist and the founder of the LEA Resource Hub. So in this training, I'll be walking you through an introduction to the Montessori preschool curriculum. So in this training, these are the things we're going to cover. So we're going to look at the practical life exercise. We're going to look at the language curriculum. We're going to look at the mathematics. And we're going to look at the cultural exercise. So basically, we're looking at four modules in this training. We're looking at four modules. So let's start with module one, which is the practical life exercise. Now, you see the subject I just mentioned now, they are the things that make up what we call the prepared environment. Now, I'm sure in the discussion about the pillars of the Montessori curriculum, you came across the prepared environment. But in this training, I'm going to talk about a little about the prepared environment. So like I said earlier, these subjects are what makes up the prepared environment. So now let's look at the characteristics of a prepared environment. Now before we look at the characteristics of a prepared environment, let's look at what a prepared environment is. Now, a prepared environment, which is also known as the Montessori classroom, is a conducive environment. I'll take it again. It's a conducive environment carefully prepared by a knowledgeable adult who takes into consideration all the necessary elements needed for the child's development. So the person that will be able to prepare this environment is someone who has been trained, someone who understands the child and what the child needs to grow and develop. So that being said, now let's look at the characteristics of a prepared environment. What are the features of a prepared environment? Now, one is, in a prepared environment, we have a single piece of materials which is made available. Now, why do we have a single piece of material? So that the children will learn to take turns. What this means is that if child A is working with the knob cylinder, child B will have to wait for child A to finish. The second thing is, characteristics is, the materials are reality based. The materials must reflect the reality of the child, must reflect what is obtainable in the child's environment. The third characteristic is the environment should be beautiful, warm, and inviting. Now, the fourth characteristic is all the materials should be child size. All the materials should be the size of the child. Now, this will provide or give the child a sense of ownership. Now, the fifth one is the furniture should be child size, like I said earlier, and it should be colorful. Now, not color riot, it should just be colorful. Now, the sixth one is the environment should be spacious. Space is very important in the prepared environment and well ventilated. Now, the seventh one is the safety of the child should be ensured, and you must continue to do this on a regular basis. Now, the ninth characteristic is the children's work is usually pasted somewhere they can see, somewhere they can touch and feel. Then in a prepared environment, the 10th characteristic is that there should be a work area where the children can work. Now, as a matter of fact, I usually tell schools, your school must have these three areas: one, learning area; two, eating area; and three, rest area. It's very important. So in a prepared environment, there's what we call the work area. Now, the last one is the environment should be a place where the teacher will observe the child. Now, like I said, space is very, very important in a prepared environment. Space is very, very important. So now let's go on to the next lesson, which is what is practical life exercise? What is practical life exercise? Now, like the name implies, practical life exercise, they are daily living activities. They are all the activities we do on a daily basis. So practical life exercise are the activities of everyday life, and they are involved in all aspects of our life. Now, the thing is that Now, as a child grows, he observes these activities in his environment. Now, these activities, they happen naturally, and he gains knowledge through the real experience of how to accomplish life skills in a purposeful way. Now, these activities are cultural. Now, when I say cultural, it means they are the activities that are done in the child's environment, and they are specific to the child's time and place. Now, practical life activities helps give the child a sense of being and belonging. Now, this is usually established through participation in daily life. Now, through practical life, the child learns about his culture and all what it is to be human. So, practical life exercise generally provides the child with experience and practice of daily living. It provides the child with experience and practice of daily living. Now, there are four areas of the practical life exercise. There are four areas. Now, these areas are: we have the care of self, we have the care of the environment, we have grace and courtesy, and we have movement of objects or control of movement. These are the four areas that the practical life exercise has been divided into by Maria Montessori. Now, before I go on, now, like, I will need to draw attention to the fact that practical life exercise is the cornerstone of the Montessori curriculum. I will explain, is the cornerstone of the Montessori curriculum, because every other subject was drawn from practical life exercise. In our daily living activities, one, we are exposed to numbers, we are exposed to maths, we are exposed to shapes, we are exposed to colors. In our daily living activities, practical life exercise, we are exposed to language. We use language to communicate with the child. We use language to talk to our friends. So, on a day-to-day basis, we use language. And it is this language that the child will acquire. Further, in the practical life exercise, daily living exercise, the children are involved in the refinement of their senses, which is a sensorial education. They are engaged in the refinement of their senses, and it's in the daily living activities that children get to understand the world, they get to understand plants, they get to understand animals, and they also get to understand themselves. So if you look at it carefully, you'll see that from what I explained, practical life exercise is a cornerstone, is the first curriculum area Montessori started working with, because she discovered that when children can do daily living activities on their own, then they are empowered to do things for themselves. Now, as we go further and look at some of the elements and the importance of practical life exercise, you're going to see how all these tie together. Now, we're going to look at the characteristics of practical life exercise. What are the characteristics of practical life exercise? Now, the first one we have here is child size material. Now, the materials in practical life exercise must be proportional to the child. So, even the size of cup or brush or whatever you're going to give the child must fit the child's hand, so that the child can use it successfully. Now, this is very important. If the material is not the size that the child can handle and relate with, then the child is going to have difficulty relating or using the item. So the first characteristic is child size materials. Now, the second one is reality base. Now, reality means the material shouldn't be artificial material. They are real object that the child sees on a day-to-day basis in his or her environment. Now, the next characteristic is self-contained. Now, what does this mean? The materials that the child will use are usually contained in a basket, tray, or set, and usually set out on a stand in a particular space. Now, this is very important. All materials must be complete. They must be complete, prepared, and is ready for use. Now, it's very important that teachers prepare the classroom a day before the child comes into the class. This is very important. So, from your observation let's say for when you observe the child today, you go on to prepare the environment against tomorrow, so that when the child comes in, everything is complete and ready for use. Now the adult in this environment is responsible to make sure the activity is prepared with everything the child would need for a successful completion of the activity. Now this helps the child's human tendency and sensitive period for order, and it is this external order that helps the child to internalize order. Now you've looked at this human tendency in the Montessori theory and the sensitive period. Now learning is structured around the sensitive period and the human tendency. Now the next characteristics of PLE is completeness. Now I've touched this when we look at self-contained completeness. Now like I said, all the materials should be complete. When you are doing transfer of water with sponge, ensure you have your sponge ready, ensure you have your sponge handy. So whatever you are doing, ensure you have that material ready and complete. Now the truth is that if something needs to be replaced at the end of any activity, you have to show the child how to replace it. It is very important. When we look at the importance of practical life exercise, you see that independence is one of the importance of practical life exercise. So you need to show the children how to replace this material. Now if the activity is incomplete for whatever reason, broken item or missing component, you need to complete it. Remove broken item, replace it with a new item. Now this is very important. The next characteristic is the materials must be functional. The material or the activity must be functional. Now what do we mean by functional? It must be useful. It must be useful. They must have a clear purpose and function in the appropriate manner. Let's say for example, you cannot be using cup to fetch water and water a flower. No, use a watering can for watering a flower. You cannot use jug to drink water, you use a cup to drink water. So each material must have a clear purpose, it must be useful, and it must be appropriate for what you want to do. Now the next characteristic is proportional. Now I think I touched this when I discussed child size material. The materials must be proportional. What do you mean by proportional? Now the material of an activity must be proportional to each other and functional in terms of size. Let's say for example, the bucket must be small enough for the child to handle but big enough to hold all the water necessary for the exercise. Let's say you want to water plants, you can't give the child a small cup. You must give the child a watering can that can take a sizable amount of water that the child needs. So the next characteristic is cultural. Now I touch cultural when I explain this thing. Now cultural simply means the material, the activity you're going to do should reflect what is obtainable in the child's current environment. It must reflect what exists in the child's current reality. So you need to choose activities which are prevalent in the culture. There should be no activity that have no relationship to the life of the living child. This is very important. For example, if there are no windows in the environment, there should be no activities or exercise that has to do with cleaning of window. If there is no dirt in the child's environment, so really you don't need any activity that has to do with use of broom. So the activities that you must do should be something that is obtainable or that is done in the child's environment. Now it is very important, especially when you are working on your practical life material, you have to be conscious and deliberate about the kind of things you bring into the child's environment. So the next one is the material should be easily cleaned. So after use, the child should be able to pick the material and clean it by himself or herself. So these are very important. So now the next one we're going to look at now is the importance of the practical life exercise. What are the importance of PLE? Now the first one is adaptation. Now practical life is the most important part of preparing a child for school. Now, it is from this area that children develop skills that aid their learning process throughout their period in school or for the rest of the classroom. Now, at first glance, practical life might appear mindless or even purposeless to many adults. You say, is this not what we do on a daily basis? What's there? However, you need to examine it and observe children carefully. Now, when you do this, you will see that children are becoming something. They are taking in the environment and they are refining what they are taking in. They are gradually reconstructing themselves from the information they are taking from the environment. Now, practical life in Montessori is purposeful activity. It develops motor control and coordination. It develops independence, concentration, and it gives the child a sense of responsibility. So here now we're going to look at some of the characteristics, the importance of the practical life exercise. And like I said earlier, we'll start with adaptation. So what is adaptation? Now, adaptation is another key element of practical life exercise. Now, adaptation occurs as the mind and body are working in harmony. Now, other scientists, apart from besides Maria Montessori, observe this. Now, the whole body movement in space of practical life activities plus the works of the hands builds intellect in children. Now, the physical growth relates to mental growth. As each child does this in the prepared environment by zipping, by opening, by buttoning, by carrying, by pouring. Now, all these activities and many more promotes movement. Now, as a child relates and interacts with his environment, the child begins to adapt, he begins to adjust, he begins to enjoy what is obtainable in the environment. Now, you should also know that the process of adaptation usually takes place when the activities are natural, the activities that the child sees on a daily basis. It helps the child to adjust and to adapt. Now, the next importance of the practical life exercise is coordination of motor skill. Now, this is very, very important. Now, one thing practical life exercise does for the child is it helps in coordination and development of motor skills. Now, there are two types of motor skills. We have the gross motor skills and the fine motor skills. The gross motor skills are the large muscles, while the fine motor skills are the smaller muscles of the hand. Now, you will see that as the child is engaged in activities of daily living, the hands of the child continue to refine themselves in preparation for so many things. One of them is writing. The fine motor skills is responsible for writing, and writing happens directly and indirectly. Indirectly, when a child engages with some materials in the environment, which I'm going to share with us later, the child continues to refine the fine motor skills. Examples of exercise like rolling of mats, picking of beans, transferring of water, carrying chairs, walking around, walking on the line, mopping, sweeping, pegging. Now, all these are activities that helps the development of the motor skills. So the next one we'll be looking at now is independence. Now, you see, independence is an essential quality of the practical life that permits children to function in their environment. Now, independence leads to self-sufficiency and capability, which build confidence in children. Now, the physical independence provided in practical life lessons equate with the psychological independence. When children begin to do things for themselves, begin to carry things by themselves, they gain this level of psychological independence, this feeling of I can do it by myself. Now, the freedom of choice that exists in the prepared environment helps children to solve problems and build social skills, and also challenge them to finish their tasks. It also allows them to learn to ask for help, which aids in their independence from adults. Now, practical life also aids children in their control and coordination of movement. Now, all this adds together and leads to independence. Now, many of the materials that exist with hand and eye coordination, as children must focus on small objects, such as the ones I mentioned, spooning of grain, to ensure the grain are not getting into the bowl. Now, this helps children to develop dexterity, because children at age 3 are building their hand strength for many tasks, especially, like I said, in coordination of movement, preparation for writing. Now, like I said earlier, practical life works with both the gross and the fine motor skills, helping children to build strength in their wrists, in their arms, and in their leg. Now, this aids in their equilibrium, making activities easier to practice. Now, practical life activities also help children to cross their midline both horizontally and vertically. Now, if you look at now, all these things come into play and it leads to independence. Now, you teach children certain tasks. Now, take note, when you want to introduce children to practical life exercise, allow them, follow them. When they show interest, then you can go ahead and allow them to do. When they don't show interest, please do not force them. Now, it is very important. Following the child is very important in the prepared environment. It has so many advantages. When you follow the child, it makes learning easier. It makes teaching in code for you easier. And it makes the learning meaningful for the child. So ultimately, practical life exercise, one of the major goals is independence, for the child to be able to do things for himself or herself. So the activities I must bring into the prepared environment, they should be activities that the children can over time do it independently. They should be activities that the children can over time do it independently. Now, the next importance is concentration. Now, concentration usually happens when children are interested in a task. When a child is interested in a task, then it's easier for the child to pay attention and concentrate. So when the child picks an activity that is interested in, working on the activities helps them to develop focus, attention, and concentration. Now, because many of the activities we be doing in practical life exercise, they are cultural exercises that are done in the child's environment with things that are obtainable in the child's environment, then it appeals to the child's interest, which will not engage the child's attention, and in the process it helps the child to develop his concentration. Now, as a matter of fact, concentration is one of the key elements a child needs to develop for the child to learn. Concentration is one of the things you need children that are coming into your class to have, because without concentration, learning cannot take place. Now, this is very important. Like you can see from the activity the child is doing, the first one is the child is trying to screw some bolts and nuts. Now, you can see the child is giving his attention to that activity. Now, the other one is peeling of egg. Now, I've seen parents who cook egg and they want to remove the shell and they deny children the opportunity to do it. Now, at first, they won't get it. Second, they might not get it. But the third time, you can be sure they have improved compared to the second and first time. Now, when you allow them to do these things, it helps them to develop their attention, focus, and concentration. These are the key elements you need to teach children when they enter the primary level of education. Now, this is very, very important. So, practical life exercises help children to develop concentration. Now, the last one we'll be looking at now is a sense of responsibility. Now, when a child is independent, then the child can do things for himself or herself. That is why it is very important, when you are doing things in the child's environment, you allow the child to be around you. You allow the child to observe what you are doing. You allow the child to participate, especially when they show interest to do it. Now, when they are exposed to these activities, they are allowed to choose, they are allowed to go ahead with activities, it develops a sense of responsibility. So when a child spills water on the floor, he knows what to do. He will get the mop and wipe the water. When a child breaks any object, he knows what to do. He will get the dustpan and clear the object. When a child has finished working with the material, the child with that sense of responsibility will help the child to take the material from the work area and return it back to the shelf. Now, like I explained earlier, now we're going to look at the four different areas of the practical life exercise. Now, the four areas, like I mentioned earlier, we have the preliminary activities, we have the care for self, we have the care for the environment, then we have grace and courtesy and control of movement. Now, what I've shared with us so far will give us the foundational basics we need to, one, teach practical life exercise, and two, develop scheme or curriculum that children can follow to become independent, develop concentration, have a sense of responsibility, refine their fine and gross motor skills, and to be able to live in a society and contribute to that society. So the first activity we're going to look at now is the preliminary activity. So what is basically the preliminary activities? Now, the preliminary activities are the indirect learning activities that prepares the child to function in the class or in the society. Now, examples of the preliminary activities are unrolling and rolling of mat, carrying of chair, carrying of tray, opening the door, and spooning grains. Now, you'll be amazed that there are some children or adults that don't even know how to carry chair. Now, some children can even drag it on the floor. So, one of the key things in PLE is modeling. So, before you do anything in presence of the child, you must be sure that what you are doing is right. Because what the child sees is what the child will do. Now, in the introductory aspect, you were exposed, you saw the power of the absorbent mind and the sensitive period. Now, whatever children see is what they take in. Children don't just admire things. What they see becomes part of them. So it's very important to model how to carry chair, how to unroll mat, how to open door, and how to do some of these activities. When children see you doing it, they want to do it. Now, from there, it begins to prepare them for advanced level of concentration, focus, and attention. Now, the next activity in this grouping is the care of self. Children need to be taught how to care for themselves. And some of the examples of activities we have here is washing of hands, washing of clothes, shoe polishing, brushing of teeth, eating, bathing. Now, like I said earlier, the child might not get it at first. Stopping the child will make him get it, will make him or her get it. So all you need to do is keep giving them the opportunity to practice. Practice is very important. Give them opportunity on a daily basis to practice. As they practice, as they learn, as they refine their skills, they become better on a daily basis. So it is very important that you do these things and allow them do it. Now, very important is when they show interest, guide them and let them do it by themselves. There's a popular saying, we said, teach me to do it myself. So once you have taught them, yours is to step away and guide them into refining and repetition. Now, the next one we'll be looking at now is the caring for the environment. Children need to be taught or need to see how to take care of the environment. Like I said earlier, it's very important what you do around children. What they see you do is what they will do. So the activities for caring for the environment include sweeping, mopping, washing of tables, setting a table, and so on and so forth. There are so many activities under this each of these groupings. Now, the next one is grace and courtesy. We need to teach children how to greet. We need to teach children how to offer and receive help. We need to teach children how to express admiration. Like somebody say, your hair is fine. You don't say, I know. Your clothes is fine. You say, I know. No. they need to reciprocate. Oh, thank you. Oh, thank you. Oh, thank you. So you need to teach them how to express admiration, how to like something, and how to receive a compliment when somebody pass it on to them. Now, in this case, where you also teach them the five magic words. You teach them the five magic words and how to use the five magic words. Now, the next group of activity is the movement of objects or control of movement. Now, when you see a child walking for the first time, the child wobbles and fall and wobbles and fall. Now, if you say, oh, this child cannot walk, oh, you now have to sit him down on a trolley, you are disempowering that child. As the child sits, stands and falls, he refines and becomes strong. The muscles of the body become strong to carry the child. So it is in doing that children really learn. So control of movement simply gives the children the opportunity to refine their skills. Now, the activity we have here is walking on the line and the silence game. Now, it is very important. Now, when you introduce the silence game in your settings, you'll be amazed how children enjoy and like this activity. You'll be amazed how they like it. You'll be amazed how they go for it. You'll be amazed how they look forward to it. So, walking on the line and the silence games helps to refine children's control of movement. So that is all for this module. So I'll take your question now. So thank you very much. I hope you've learned a thing or two. So a quick recap of what we've learned so far. Now, we looked at the practical life exercise, and we say the practical life exercise are the activities, are the daily living activities that children are involved or are engaging on a daily basis. Even adults who are involved in the daily living activities. Then we went on to look at the characteristics of a practical of the prepared environment. We look at the characteristics of the prepared environment. Then we went on to look at what practical life exercise is. We look at the characteristics of practical life exercise, the importance of practical life exercise, and the groupings, the different sections of the practical life exercise. Look at the preliminary activities, look at the care of self, look at the care of environment, look at grace and courtesy, and look at control. We looked at control of movement. So thank you very much for listening and taking notes. I will see you in the Q&A section. So expect module 2, which is going to be an introduction of the Montessori language curriculum for preschool. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.